The knowledge of Islam is precious like gold, because keys to success this knowledge does hold. The knowledge of Islam is precious like gold, because keys to success this knowledge does hold.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام عليك يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا حبيب الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا نبي الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا نور الله. It is a glad tiding from the Prophet of mankind, the peace of our heart and mind. The most generous and kind, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, whoever will recite salat upon me, I will intercede for him. Sallu ala al-habib, sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad. My dear Islamic brothers, today we are going to start a new silsila, Blessing of Islam. Insha'Allah, in this silsila, we will ask question about the Islam and we will get the blessings and we will learn the Islamic knowledge. It is narrated that someone once had a dream in which he saw a deceased person wear the cap of fire worshipper on his head. The dreaming person asked the reason for this. The deceased replied, "Whenever I heard or mentioned the blessed name of the Holy Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, I did not use to recite salat. This sin has caused the loss of my iman and mystical knowledge." Mufti Sahib, what do you say about this dream? And what is the definition of iman? And there is any impact over the iman due to bad deeds and good deeds?
As far as this deen is concerned, that on the behalf of any deen can be considered a person as a non-Muslim or fire worshipper, or as a people of person of hell can be considered that a person who was Muslim, and when we see that person in our deen, so he was in hell. So basically we have criterion, and that criterion is called Sharia. According to Sharia, we count the people, we consider people, who is that. If a person was Muslim, so we will consider that person as a Muslim, though after his death, we see that person in our deen as ma'adallah fire worshipper, or as a non-Muslim. Because Sharia tells us that if a person is Muslim, he is claiming to be Muslim, he recites Kalima Tayyiba, and he says to be a Muslim, so we will consider that person as a Muslim. And the second matter, that if we see any person in dream as a person of hell, so on the behalf of that dream, can we consider that person as a person of hell? So we can't consider that person, because dream is not any kind of proof in Sharia. Only the dreams of prophets are proofs, because their dreams are also one kind of wahi. So that's why if any prophet sees any dream, that would be considered the message of Allah in deen. That would be considered as the revelation of Almighty Allah. But the deen of any ordinary person, even the deen of any wali, can't be considered as a proof for a person. So that's why if we see any person in hellfire after his death, so we can't say this person is a person of hell and he is in hell now. So these kind of deens are only to show something, to make the people understand something. So in that meaning, we should take these deens. And the second question, what is the definition of iman? What is the definition of belief and faith? So iman means to testify all the essentials of Islam, which are called zaruriyat-e-deen, are the essentials of Islam. So whosoever accepts all the essentials of Islam, he believes in Allah, he believes in his last prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he believes in messengers, in prophets, in the books of Allah, in hell, in paradise, and in angels. So whosoever believe in all these things, he will be considered as Muslim, and his believing in these things is called Iman. And the another thing, that is there any difference between Iman and Islam? So I would say, as far as the matter of the meaning of Iman and Islam is concerned, so there is difference between the meanings of these two, because Iman belongs to heart and Islam refers to following and to copying someone. So but as far as the meaning of Mumin and Muslim is concerned, so every Muslim is Mumin and every Mumin is Muslim. We can't say this person is Muslim but he's not Mumin, or that person is Mumin but that person is not Muslim. Every Muslim is Mumin and every Mumin is Muslim. But literal meaning of Iman and Islam are different. So that is the difference between these two meanings.
There is any impact over the Iman due to bad deeds and good deeds?
We can take this question in two ways. One is this, that if a person commits any sin, due to committing that sin, a person can become a kafir, a person can become an infidel. So in the answer of this question, I would say the person will never become infidel and kafir due to any sin and due to not offering any first, due to not fulfilling any essential duty of Islam. Because Iman belongs to our heart. As long as the testifying of the essentials of Islam is in our heart, we are Mumin, we are Muslim. So when a person believes in all the essentials of Islam and after that he doesn't fulfill any duty of Islam, he will be considered as Muslim. But is there any impact of bad deeds over the Iman of any person? So in this meaning, there are some impact. For example, if a person commits fornication, he doesn't offer prayer, he doesn't fulfill Islamic duties, and he commits sin, and he is indulged in committing sin day and night, so his Iman would be weak. And because when his Iman would become weak, so then maybe Shaitan will do something with him, Shaitan will deceive him, and Shaitan will put him in the hellfire. So in that way, there may be some impacts of bad deeds over the Iman of a person. But according to the first meaning of this question, there is no impact of any sin over Iman.
What did you say about this, and what are the commandments of Sharia about this? Iman decrease and increase, and as we can say, the Waliullah, the saint of Allah Azza wa Jal, so their Iman is more than us and our Iman is less.
Basically, Iman belongs to heart. Okay, as it is mentioned in the Holy Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal said, Ulaika kataba fi qulubihimul Iman. These are the people, in their hearts Almighty Allah inscribed Iman. So fi qulubihimul Iman, Iman is in the hearts of the people. And in the other ayah, Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ, and Iman hasn't yet entered into your heart. So basically, Iman belongs to heart. As long as the Iman is in the heart of a person, he is Mumin. Now, the Iman of any person is more than any other person or not? So the answer of this question is that Iman increases and decreases, but in particular meaning. What is that? Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Holy Quran, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. When the verses of the Holy Quran, when the verses of Almighty Allah are recited in front of them, their Iman increases. So in which meaning the Iman increase? In the meaning of being strong or weak, in that way Iman increases. We can say the Iman of Wali is more strong than the Iman of a sinner person. So in that way we can say Iman of Wali is stronger than the Iman of another person, but in size, that his Iman is in size or in quantity. The iman of a person is more than the other person, we can't say that. So we can't say that wali has two iman and the sinner person has one iman. It doesn't make sense. And it's not the case. The size of iman of wali is more than the size of iman of a sinner person. So in that meaning, there is no difference between the iman of a sinner person and iman of the wali. But in kafiya, being strong or being weak, in this meaning, there is a difference between the iman of a wali and in the iman of a sinner person. And in that meaning, Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Holy Quran, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. When the verses of Almighty Allah are recited in front of them, their iman increased. So in that meaning, we can say iman decreases, increases or decreases. But in the size or in the quantity, there is no difference between the iman of two people.
Mutsab, as you use word essentials of Islam, so what are the essentials of Islam, and there is any particular definition for essentials of Islam?
The word essential of Islam is called Zaruriyat-e-Deen. Before that, I will complete the answer of the first question. When we use the word Iman, sometimes the word Iman is used in two meanings. One is Iman itself, and the another meaning of Iman is perfection of Iman, which is called Kamal-e-Iman. So there is no difference in Iman itself, but there may be difference in the perfection of Iman. To what extent the Iman of a wali is perfect, that is more than the Iman of a sinner person. So perfection of Iman can increase and that can decrease, but Iman itself can't increase and can't decrease. And now your question, that what is the meaning of essentials of Islam? So basically, essentials of Islam, in easy word we can say, the main beliefs of Islam are essentials of Islam. Those things in which having belief is compulsory. If someone doesn't believe in any of them, he is not Muslim. He will never be considered as a Muslim. So what are essentials of Islam? The definition of essentials of Islam is that those beliefs of Islam which are known by every Muslim, whether he is a scholar or an ordinary person, but not too ordinary person, that ordinary person who sits in the company of scholars, who is fond of learning something from scholars, and who goes to the company of pious people, who goes to the company of scholars, and he has zeal for learning the Islamic knowledge. So if that kind of person is meant here, so those essentials of Islam, those beliefs of Islam which are known by a scholar and ordinary people, according to the definition what I have told you, so according to that definition, so those beliefs which are known by scholars and ordinary people are called essentials of Islam, Zaruriyat-e-Deen. And that's why we will say, if any ordinary person who doesn't have any kind of knowledge, he lives in any jungle, he lives any in city, but he is very far from Islam, he never offered any prayer, he never observed far, he never performed Hajj. So that kind of people, if they don't know, so there won't be any kind of change in the meaning of Zaruriyat-e-Deen. So Zaruriyat-e-Deen, and in the example of Zaruriyat-e-Deen, we will say, as the oneness of Allah, and Almighty Allah is worthy of worship, and the messengers of Allah having belief in all the messengers of Allah, having belief in all the prophets of Allah, and having belief in hell and paradise and in angels, and having belief in all the books of Allah, having belief in the Holy Quran. So all these things are essentials of Islam. And as we say that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final prophet of Almighty Allah azza wa jal, that is also one of the essentials of Islam. So these beliefs are called essentials of Islam.
Mutasab, another question is, when a person becomes Muslim, it is necessary for him to learn all these essentials of Islam, or if he do not learn these essentials of Islam, so we will consider him as a non-believer, as a infidel, or he will be considered a Muslim if he do not learn these essentials of Islam?
A person becomes Muslim when he accepts the oneness of Allah and the prophethood of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That time it is not necessary, it is not first for being Muslim to learn all the essentials of Islam. But it is compulsory for every Muslim to learn about Islamic teachings. Because when a person becomes Muslim, that time Sharia considers him Muslim because he has accepted the oneness of Allah. He has been Iman in Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal and in the prophethood of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But because there are many essentials of Islam, so it may happen because of his ignorance and because of his not learning the teachings of Islam, he commits and he says any statement of kufr, any blasphemous word. So that's why it is very necessary, because this time the people are very far from Sharia, they are very far from Islamic knowledge. They have a lot of knowledge about worldly matters, but they don't have knowledge about offering prayer and the obligatory acts in prayer. Even they don't know. So if they don't know essentials of Islam, it may happen that due to their ignorance, they fall in infidelity. So for that purpose, it is necessary to learn Islamic beliefs. So for that purpose, it is necessary, but for being Muslim, it is not necessary. So if a person doesn't know the essentials of Islam, but he doesn't deny any essential of Islam, he will be considered as a Muslim. It means when a person recites Kalima Tayyiba, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, when he testifies the oneness of Allah and prophethood, he becomes Muslim. But after that, if he denies any of the essential of Islam, he will become kafir. So that's why to protect his iman, to protect his belief, it would be obligatory upon him to learn the teachings of Islam, to the beliefs of Islam.
As compared to iman, another word in the comparison of iman is kufr, infidelity. What is the meaning of infidelity? And there is any difference between kufr and polytheism? What do you say about this? Or both are alike, disbelief and shirk?
When infidelity is opposite to belief, infidelity is opposite to Islam. So when we have defined the meaning of iman, the iman is to testify all the essentials of Islam. So infidelity would be against that. Denying any of the essentials of Islam would be kufr. That would be infidelity. Accepting all the essentials of Islam is iman, all the essentials. But denying even one of the essentials of Islam would be considered as kufr. That is the definition of kufr. As far as the second word, the word shirk. So the word shirk is different from the word of kufr, because the word kufr is very general. The infidelity word is very general, because Christians are also infidel, Jews are also infidels, and atheists are also infidels, but they are not polytheists. The word polytheism is a specific word. What is the meaning of polytheism? What is the meaning of shirk? So the meaning of shirk, to associate partner with Almighty Allah in one out of two things. One thing is in the being of Allah. If a person considers any being or any personality, his being as the being of Allah, that the being of that personality is as the being of Allah, that Almighty Allah is wajibul wujud, his being is compulsory. So if a person considers any other personality other than Allah to be wajibul wujud, then it would be shirk and the person would be mushrik. And the second thing is that if a person considers anything or any person to be worthy of worship, that would be shirk and the person would be mushrik. So the meaning of shirk is specific. Considering anything or any person as a partner of Allah, to associate anything or any person with Almighty Allah is shirk. So that is the difference between the meaning of kufr and the meaning of shirk.
Sahib, what is the importance and bounties of iman? And what are the evils of infidelity?
The importance of iman, I think every Muslim knows that going to paradise, entering paradise, depends upon our iman. If a person is mu'min, he has firm belief, his iman is sound, then he would be able to enter paradise. And if he is not mu'min, he doesn't have belief, then he will never be able to enter paradise. He will enter hell forever. and the hell would be abode for him forever. He will remain there for the eternal life. And for the importance and for the excellence of Iman, Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Holy Quran, in many places, as we know, that Allah Azza wa Jalla said, whosoever does good deeds, whether he is male or female, and the condition is this, that he is Muslim, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنُونَ, the condition is this, that he would be mu'min, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاتًا طَيِّبًا, we will give him the pure life, we will reward him the pure life. So the person who is doing good deeds, he is offering prayer, he is performing Hajj, he is observing fast, he is doing all the good deeds according to his attitude and behavior. He is very nice person, he is well mannered, he has learned the knowledge of Islam. But after all these things, it is conditioned to enter paradise and to be accepted in the court of Allah to have Iman, to have belief. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said in this ayah, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى, whosoever does good deeds, whether he is male or female, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ, but the condition is this, that the person should be mu'min. Then, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. So the person will be given reward, he will be given admission into paradise, he will get the blessings of Almighty Allah when he is mu'min. Other than that, if he does all the good deeds in this life, but he is not mu'min, then he will enter hell. And the evils of kufr, so because our end result depends upon our belief, if that is right, then we may enter paradise. And if that is wrong, mean a person dies in the state of kufr, so then his abode is only hell. He will never ever enter paradise. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Holy Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا لَا يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابُ وَلَا هُمْ يُنظَرُونَ. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, indeed those people who disbelieved, وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ, and they died in the state of kufr, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ, these are the people, upon them the curse of Allah, وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ, and the curse of angels, وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ, and the curse of all the people upon them, خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا, they will remain in that curse, they will remain in the hellfire forever, that will be their abode forever. لَا يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابُ, the punishment will never be lightened from them, that will increase, never decrease. The punishment will increase, that will never decrease, that will never be lightened from them. وَلَا هُمْ يُنْدَرُونَ, and they will never be given any respite. They have respite in this world, they have time in this world. In this world, they can change their belief, they can accept Islam, they can have belief in Allah, they can do every good deed, they can come in the fold of Islam, they can come in the fold of Iman. But after death, there is no respite, there is no time, and there is no concession for them. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا, they will be in hell forever. And so that is the evil of infidelity. And in the same way, Allah Azza wa Jalla describes the evil of shirk as well. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Holy Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاء. Indeed, Almighty Allah will never forgive to be associated. Almighty Allah will never forgive shirk. And He may forgive whatever is other than shirk for whosoever He wills. So the shirk and kufr will never be forgiven. There is only one way to abstain from kufr and shirk, and that is accepting Iman, that is accepting Islam in this world, not in hereafter. So that is the evil of shirk. So kufr and shirk will never be forgiven, and other than that, it's upon Almighty Allah Azza wa Jalla, if with His blessing, due to His blessing, or due to the intercession of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, due to intercession of any wali, due to the intercession of any pious person, Almighty Allah may forgive that person who has abstained from kufr and shirk and who died in the state of Iman. So that's why Iman is very, very important. Other than Iman, all the blessing will be ruined. A day will come when a person has to depart from this world. All the blessing will be ruined. All the blessing will depart from that person. That person is departing from this world. And all the blessings are departing from that person. And that time, now it will be seen. What is his state? What is his condition? He is departing this world in the state of Iman, or he is departing this world in the state of Kufr. As Allah said in the Holy Quran, فَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ فَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ Never die unless in the state of Iman. When the time of death will come to you, you must be in the state of Iman. Otherwise, there is no forgiveness from Almighty Allah, and there is no intercession, and it is the intercession is also mentioned in the Holy Quran in many places. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Holy Quran, La tanfa'uha shafa'atun. Intercession will never be beneficial for these people who die in the state of infidelity and in the state of shirk. So that's why abstaining from kufr and shirk is very, very important, because our afterlife depends upon our iman.
What are the commandments of Sharia about Murtad? What's mean by Murtad?
Murtad is another term in this perspective, because when we discuss about Iman, so there is word Iman, there is word Kuf, there is word Shirk, there is word Irtidad, there is word Murtad, Muslim, Kafir, Mushrik and Murtad. All these are the terminology of Islam. So who is Murtad? Murtad is apostate. The person who was Muslim and after being Muslim, he left Islam and he entered into the fold of kufr. For example, a person was Muslim, but he denied the obligation of prayer, 5-time prayer. He denied the obligation of zakah. He denied the obligation of hajj. He denied any essential of Islam. He denied the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as to be the final prophet. So that person has left Iman and now he has entered into the fold of infidelity. So the person who was Muslim, but after being Muslim, he left Islam, that person is called Murtad. And the punishment of Murtad is also like infidel and polytheist people, as Allah said in the Holy Quran, وَمَنْ يَرْتَدِدْ مِنْكُمْ عَنْ دِينِهِ فَيَمُتْ وَهُوَ كَافِرٌ فَأُولَٰئِكَ حَابِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ Whosoever among you turned from his deen, left his deen, and then he die in the state of kufr, فَيَمُتْ وَهُوَ كَافِرٌ, and he dies in the state of kufr, so the same punishment is for that person, that his deeds in this world and in the hereafter will be ruined, will be destructed, will be eliminated. He will never get any reward of any kind of good deed what he did in this life. And after that, khalidina fiha, he will enter hell and he will remain there forever. So particularly for people like us who are Muslim, it is a warning, because alhamdulillah, with the blessing of Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal, created us in the state of Iman. Alhamdulillah, by birth we are Muslim. We were born in the house of Muslim, and due to that, alhamdulillah, we are Muslim. But protection of Iman is very important. Now it's upon us. That was the blessing of Allah, that we were born in the house of a Muslim. But now it's upon us that we try to protect our Iman, we try to prevent our Iman or not. And so we can know the importance of Iman and the importance of being worried about our Iman, so we can know that very easily.
Mufti Sahib, as we heard about the punishments of infidels, murtadin and polytheists, so what will be the reward for Muslims? What will be the reward for that people? They die on the Iman.
For those people, as I have recited one ayah of the Holy Quran, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. Whosoever does good deed, whether he is male or female, and وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ, and he is mu'min, he is believer, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً, Almighty Allah will reward him with the pure life, with pure life. That pure life would be in paradise, in Jannah. and that person will remain in Jannah forever. And there are many ayah in the Holy Quran, even I can claim that there are hundreds of verses of the Holy Quran are about the importance of Iman. As in one place Allah Azzawajal said, وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Give glad tidings to those people who are mu'min and they accepted Islam and they did good deeds. أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. They are jannat for them. They are gardens for them. In garden there are many blessings of Allah Azzawajal. In another verse Allah Azza wa Jalla said, wal asri innal insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat. So in this verse as well Allah Azza wa Jalla told us the importance of Iman. So there are many ayat of the Holy Quran in which the importance of Iman and the dignity of Iman, the exaltedness of Iman is mentioned.
Mufti Sahib, in the light of your answer we came to know that this matter is very sensitive. The Iman matter is very sensitive. So what do you say and what do you recommend to us that how can we protect our Iman?
Yeah, really, it is very important to protect our Iman. And for that purpose, basically, what can we do? First of all, learning knowledge is very important, because without knowledge, a person can fall in the cave of infidelity. And learning knowledge, particularly the knowledge of beliefs, because Iman belongs to belief, so particularly learning the knowledge of belief is very important. The second thing is that the person should be worried about his Iman, about his belief, because when a person considers his Iman as a wealth, then he tries his best to protect. Otherwise, if there is no importance in his mind about his belief, so why will he do anything for the protection of his Iman? So that's why being worried about our Iman and to ponder over the importance of Iman is very important and is very essential. The third thing is that to sit in the company of pious people who have fear of Almighty Allah in their hearts and who are the true follower of Sharia and who are the true lover of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and who weep in the fear of Almighty Allah and who have ponderance about their Iman, about their end, in which state they will depart this world. So in sitting in the company of those people is very important. So that is another cure for the weakness of Iman. And the fourth thing is that we should supplicate about our Iman. As when we offer janaza prayer, that time we supplicate that time, O Allah, whosoever dies among us, so he will die in the state of Iman, and whosoever lives in this world, he will live on the path of Islam. So as we supplicate, as we do that supplication, so in our daily routine, that should be the part of our life, and that supplication would be the part of our supplication. As we supplicate for the worldly wealth, for the worldly benefit, for the worldly advantages, and for the treatment, for the cure of our patients, so particularly for the protection of our Iman, we must supplicate in the court of Allah Azza wa Jal. So learning the Islamic knowledge, being and sitting in the company of pious people and thinking about the importance of our Iman and supplicating in the court of Allah Azza wa Jal. So these are the means, I think, through which we can protect our Iman.
Mufti Sahib, there is any particular dua that we can recite to protect our Iman?
In Shajara Attariya, there are some supplications, there are some prayers. So if we make those prayers as our habit, as our routine, so inshallah they may help us, they may assist us. And particularly we can say whatever words are in our mind for the protection of our Iman, so we should do those supplications. So O Allah, protect our Iman. O Allah, keep us on the path of Islam. And as in there is one prayer in Surah Al-Fatiha as well, Ihdinas Sirat Al-Mustaqim. O Allah, keep us on the right path, keep us on the straight path. So keep us on the straight path means till the last moment of our life. O Allah, keep us on the right path. So if a person recites this dua again and again and he supplicates this dua, Ihdinas Sirat Al-Mustaqim, O Allah, keep me on the right path, O Allah, keep us on the right path, straight path, so it would be beneficial in this matter as well.
So what do you say about hypocrites? Because we spoke about matters about Iman, Islam, Kufr, Shirk. And what is the definition of hypocrite? Who are hypocrites?
That is another kind in this perspective in which we are discussing now. Mumin and Mushrik and Kafir and Murtad and Munafiq. So that is another terminology. Hypocrite are those people who are Muslim but only apparently. They utter the statement of Iman. They claim to be Muslim. But inwardly, in their heart, they deny Islam. From their mouth, they say, we are Muslim. As Allah said and told us about these people in the Holy Quran, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. Among the people, there are some people who say, we believe in Allah, we believe in the Day of Judgment, but Allah said, وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. They are not believers. They are claiming, آمنا بالله وباليوم الآخر, we have believed in Allah and in the Day of Judgment, but Allah Azza wa Jal is refuting their claim. وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. They are not believers. Why? يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهِ. They try to deceive Allah. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And they try to deceive mu'minin, believers. وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ. But they are not deceiving, but their own selves. They are deceiving their own self. They are not deceiving Almighty Allah. They are not deceiving Muslims. They are not deceiving mu'min. Because the condition of their heart, the state of their heart is known by Allah. Almighty Allah know what is in their heart. Though they claim by their tongue they are Muslim, but Allah knows better. There is no iman in their heart. What is in their heart? Allah said, فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ. فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ. There is disease in their heart. There is illness in their heart. فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. And Allah increased their disease. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. So there is painful punishment for them. There is painful torment for them. Because they used to tell a lie in this world. They used to tell a lie with Muslims. When they met Muslim, they say, we are with you. We have believed. وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شِيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ. But when they met their devils, their leaders, their friends, and their hypocrites, brothers, then they say, إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ. We are with you. Indeed, we are with you. إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ. إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. We are only making fun of these Muslims. We are only making mockery. So these people were munafiqeen. And they were called hypocrites in the term of Quran. And they are one of the worst kinds of infidels. And that's why the punishment is very severe. Allah said in the Holy Quran, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. The infidels, indeed, the hypocrites, would be in the lowest part of the hell. They will be there. Why? مُذَبْذَبِينَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ. They were hesitated between Islam and Kufr. To where they should go. They were hesitated between these two. لا إله إلا الله ولا إله إلا الله. Neither they were there nor they were here. So they were hesitated in their condition, but they were infidel, and that's why they will enter hell. إن المنافقين في الدرك الأسفل من النار. And they will be in the lowest part of the hell. So that is punishment for these people. So the hypocrites of those people who claim to be Muslim by their tongue, but inwardly in their heart they are not Muslims. They are non-believers. So these people are called hypocrites.
In these days, can we say to any person he is a hypocrite?
Declaring a person as a hypocrite is a very difficult matter. We are not allowed to say that word for any person, because we are ordered to consider a person Muslim when he is claiming as a Muslim, and there is no sign of kufr in him. We are not finding any sign of kufr in that person, so we will consider that person as a Muslim. If there is any sign of kufr, if he has committed any kufr, or if he has said any blasphemous word, so according to the intensity of that statement, of that action, we will give any kind of verdict about that person. But when a person is claiming to be a Muslim, we will consider that person a Muslim. At the time of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, some people were called munafiqeen and hypocrites, because with the blessing of Allah, the Holy Prophet ﷺ knew them, Almighty Allah gave information to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about these hypocrites. So due to the informing from Almighty Allah to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and through Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the companion of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they knew these hypocrites and they called these people as hypocrites. But in this time, because we don't know what is in the heart of a person, so that's why we can't claim about a person to be hypocrite. If he is claiming to be a Muslim, we will consider him as a Muslim. And if he is claiming to be an infidel or any kind of other belonging or another religion, we will consider that person the person of that religion. So we can't say any person to be hypocrite and munafiq.
Inshallah, Mufti, last question. How we can get knowledge about Iman, Islam, Kufr, Shirk and these kind of topics? How we can get knowledge?
Alhamdulillah, there are many books regarding this knowledge. As the first part of Bahari Shariat is also about beliefs, but in easy word and in a very beautiful way, there is a very important beneficial book by Amir al-Sunnah, Kufriya Kalimat ke bare mein Sawal Jawab, question and answer regarding blasphemous words. That is very, very important, very easy book, and that is very necessary to read and to learn what is in that book. So I think if a person reads that book, inshallah, he will get proper knowledge regarding this matter.
Jazakallah khair. Sallu ala al-habib sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad.
The knowledge of Islam is precious like gold, because keys to success this knowledge does.